सो कैन यू सी दी पीडीएफ, कैन यू सी माय विंडो?
यस सर, यस सर.
ओके, आई हैव शेयर्ड टुडेज टॉपिक एक्चुअली. सो वन मोर वीडियो आई हैव शेयर्ड इन द चैट बॉक्स, यू कैन गो थ्रू दैट वीडियो एंड देन देयर इज अ न्यूमेरिकल प्रॉब्लम, सो यू कैन इंक्लूड दैट इन द न्यूमेरिकल प्रॉब्लम, ओके, इन योर असाइनमेंट. Today I am going to discuss about, first of all, VCR cyclone TS, PH and HS diagrams. So VCR cycle, as you know, comprises of the four components. One is the evaporator. Second one is compressor. Third is condenser. And the fourth one is the expansion device. Okay. So these are the components: compressor, condenser, expansion device, evaporator. I hope that you remember the name of the lines which join evaporator to the compressor. It is known as the suction line. So this is the suction line. This line which joins the compressor to the condenser is known as discharge line. The line which connects the condenser to the evaporator is known as the liquid line, and the line which connects the expansion device to the evaporator is known as expansion line. So these are the various line: expansion line, suction line, discharge line or delivery line, then liquid line, then expansion line. Now this is the TS diagram on the right hand side, where you can see state point one is the entry to the compressor. 2 is the exit from the compressor in the superheated state. 2 to 3 is the heat rejection in the condenser at constant pressure. And 3 to 4 is the process in the expansion device. And 4 to 1 is the heat addition to the refrigerant in the evaporator. And this process is also at constant pressure. So PE is equal to constant in the evaporator. PC is equal to constant in the condenser. 1 to 2 is isentropic compression, so entropy remains constant. And 3 to 4 is enthalpy is equal to constant, because it's a isenthalpic process in the isenthalpic expansion in the capillary tube or expansion device. Now we want to draw this diagram on a pH chart also. Mostly the pH chart is used when we have to do large number of calculations. We have to calculate large number of enthalpies. Usually it is not required for a single stage VCR cycle. So this cycle which I have shown you here is a single stage VCR cycle, and it is also known as, not only the VCR, it is also known as, you can add to it, simple saturated. It is simple saturated VCR cycle. Why simple saturated? Because there are two state points, that is state point number 1 and state point number 3. So here the value of x is equal to 0, here the value of x is equal to 1. So these are the two points which are in the saturated vapor and saturated liquid state. That is why this cycle is also known as simple saturated vapor compression cycle. If there is any other type of the cycle where the point 3 is not on the saturated liquid line and point 1 is not on the saturated vapor line, then it won't be known as the simple saturated vapor compression cycle. So you can see here, if this is the critical point, so here the temperature is TC, critical temperature. On the right hand side of this critical point, this curve is known as saturated vapor line. It is saturated vapor line, and the curve on the left hand side of the critical point is known as saturated liquid line. So this is the saturated liquid line. Okay, so this, the left one is the schematic diagram of the vapor compression cycle, and the right one is the TS diagram. Now we are going to plot this vapor compression cycle on a pH plot also. So let us see how it looks on a pH and HS diagram. First of all, let us look into on the pH diagram. So pH diagram is on the left hand side. This is the pH diagram. So you know the first process, the process 1 to 2 is happening in the compressor, where the entropy remains constant. So you can see here 0.1 to 2. This is 0.1 and this is 0.2. So this process is isentropic compression in the compressor. Entropy remains constant. So it's an inclined line. Okay. Now it's a pH diagram. So 2 to 3 process. In 2 to 3 process occurs in a condenser. It's at constant pressure. So it's a straight horizontal line. Okay. Then process 3 to 4, if you see, it's an isenthalpic process. During this, the enthalpy remains constant. So on a pH diagram, it's a vertical line from 3 to 4. So this is line 3 to 4. Okay. Now 4 to 1. 4 to 1 is happening in the evaporator at constant pressure. So 4 to 1 is a constant pressure process in the evaporator. So here you can see the various processes. In the upper diagram, it was the, yes. Now you can see both the diagrams simultaneously. On the top, it is, on the top right, it is the TS diagram. On the left side, it is the pH diagram. Okay. So if there is any problem, you can ask. Have you understood it? Okay. Now let us proceed to the HS diagram. Now, HS diagram is nothing but the Mollier diagram. Mollier diagram you study in case of steam. So here what we are going to do is we are also going to represent this vapor compression cycle on a Mollier diagram. So on a Mollier diagram, the critical point would be somewhere here. Okay. This is the critical point somewhere here. So this is the shape of the Mollier diagram, HS diagram, enthalpy entropy diagram. Now let us once again start from the point number 1. 1 to 2 is the constant entropy. Now it is a HS diagram, so it's going to be a vertical line. So you can see it here. So process 1 to 2 is a vertical line. Then I have shown the two constant pressure lines in PC and PE. These are the two constant pressure lines. So from 2 to 3, it is the condensation taking place in the condenser. Okay. So it is at constant pressure PC. Then 3 to 4, if you see the diagram, pH diagram, it's a vertical line there because the enthalpy is constant. Here on the HS plot, it's going to be a horizontal line because enthalpy is constant along the horizontal lines. So 3 to 4 is the horizontal line for the constant enthalpy process, which is occurring in a capillary tube, thermostatic expansion valve or automatic expansion valve, depending upon what type of load we are catering to. Okay. Then 4 to 1 is the process which is taking place in the evaporator and it is at constant pressure. So this is how the cycles are shown on the three type of the diagrams, TS, PH and HS diagram. You can be asked to represent the cycle on the PV diagram also. So try to make that PV diagram. Now one more thing, important thing about it is process 3 to 4 is a throttling process and throttling is always an irreversible process. So that is why it is shown by a dotted line. So that you should keep in mind. But other processes we are considering to behave as a reversible processes. Now the next topic is effect of various parameters on the performance of a VCR cycle or vapor compression cycle actually. Now in this topic we are going to discuss the effect of number one, variation in evaporator pressure. This is the first thing. The second one is the variation in the condenser pressure. The third is the effect of the subcooling in the condenser. And the fourth is the effect of superheating in the suction line, evaporator, and both. So these are the four topics which we are intended to learn in some part in today's class and some part in the later classes. So first of all, I would go for the first topic, which is the variation in the evaporator pressure. Now the question arises, why should the evaporator pressure change actually? So let me move on to the next page. So variation in evaporator pressure, variation in evaporator pressure or temperature. So it's quite natural when the pressure will change, the temperature will also change because both are dependent on each other. So if you increase the saturation pressure in the evaporator, the saturation temperature in the evaporator will also increase. So if the evaporator pressure decreases, the temperature will also decrease. So that is, now we are going to see why should evaporator temperature or pressure vary, how it can vary actually, okay, whether it can increase, it can also decrease. Now basically the evaporator temperature or pressure is very much dependent upon the cooling load, okay. So it is depending upon the cooling load. As the cooling load increases on the evaporator, that is, we are putting more products in the system for cooling. So basically what it means is, suppose your refrigerator, I am considering refrigerator at the moment, there is there are very less products, the shelves are empty, there is lot of space in the evaporator, in the refrigerator. You have brought certain products from the market which are at the ambient temperature, say 30 or 35 degrees Celsius, and you want to store them at the lower temperature, you keep them in the evaporator. Now what happens when you keep them in the evaporator? Till before this time, the space, there was a lot of space in the refrigerator and there was very less load on the evaporator. Now suddenly you have brought certain products from the market, you are keeping them in the refrigerator, so suddenly you have increased the load on the refrigeration system or the refrigerator. Now what will happen when there are more loads? There is more heat which is being produced from these products. So this causes to increase the rate of evaporation in the evaporator. So refrigerant will now start evaporating at a higher rate. Okay, earlier because there was very less load, it was only meeting the demand corresponding to the load which is entering from the outside, because the outside temperature is say 35 degrees Celsius and the cabinet temperature or the refrigerator temperature, inside temperature is, let us say, minus 10 degrees Celsius. So if outside is at 35, inside is at minus 10, so there has been there would always be some heat transfer into the system. So the evaporator or the refrigerator was taking care of that particular load only. But now in the present scenario, when you have brought certain products from outside and you are keeping it inside the refrigerator, that means you are putting more load on the refrigerator, and suddenly for a some time, for a period of half an hour, for 1 hour, the load on the evaporator is more, because now the cooling of those products has started. When the cooling has started, it means the heat transfer from the products is taking place to the refrigerant, which is flowing in the evaporator coil actually. Okay, so that is why I say there is increase in the rate of the evaporation in the evaporator. Now there is another thing. Here I am considering that the compressor is running at a constant RPM. Now compressor is running at a constant RPM. Once it is running at constant RPM, it sucks the refrigerant vapor at a constant rate. Okay. Now if it is a constant RPM compressor, so its suction of refrigerant from the evaporator will be at a constant rate only. Now, but what has happened now? Now, because the rate of evaporation has increased, the compressor is still sucking the refrigerant at the constant rate as previously it was sucking. Now, what will happen? Now, but the rate of the refrigerant generation has increased due to the load, due to the higher cooling load. Hence, compressor cannot meet the increased load initially, and hence some quantity of the refrigerant will accumulate in the evaporator. That means the compressor will suck at the rate at which it is running actually, but the rate of generation of the refrigerant in the evaporator is more. So what will happen? Some refrigerant will not be sucked and it will be remaining in the evaporator only. So when it will remain in the evaporator only, so you know, if we are putting more gas in the same volume, so the pressure will increase. So that is the reason for the increase of the pressure in the evaporator when we increase the load on the evaporator. Similarly, if we remove the products from the evaporator, what will happen? Suddenly the load will reduce on the evaporator, and hence the evaporator pressure will reduce. Okay, so this is the reason for increase or decrease of the evaporator pressure. So when the evaporator pressure in the evaporator will increase, simultaneously the temperature will also increase. So any question till now? Okay, if there is no question, I will proceed further. So it means now we want to analyze what is the effect of increase in the evaporator pressure or temperature on the performance of the vapor compression system. So let us see how it is going to affect. Now this is the effect of increase of evaporator pressure from PE to PE dash. So this is the topic, effect of increase of evaporator pressure from PE to PE dash. So it means if the pressure here is say 1 bar, then it has increased to, let us say, 1.5 bar. Okay, that is the meaning of the increase of the evaporator pressure. And simultaneously, when the pressure will increase, the temperature of the evaporator will also increase. Now let us see these two cycles which I have drawn on the TS diagram as well as on the pH diagram. So there are two cycles which you can see here. The first cycle is 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So this cycle is for the case when the load on the evaporator has not increased. Once the load will increase, what will happen? As I told you already, there will be accumulation of the refrigerant inside the evaporator coil. When there is more refrigerant in the evaporator coil, there would be increase in the pressure, because the volume of the volume of the evaporator coil is same. So more mass of the refrigerant would be there in the same volume. When there is more mass of the refrigerant in the same volume, the density will also increase, and hence the pressure will also increase. You know, when the density increases, pressure will also increase, or when the pressure increases, density increases. So same thing is happening in this particular case. Now when the pressure increases, let us say though the pressure has increased to PE dash, now the cycle changes to, actually now the initial point at the entry to the compressor is switched to 1 dash. It is shown here, it is now 1 dash, and then the isentropic compression is taking place up to 2 dash. After that, if you will see, the condensation earlier was taking place from point number 2 to 3. Now it is taking place from 2 dash to 3 actually. So now basically the heat rejection has reduced because the evaporator pressure has increased. That is visible from the TS diagram also. So similarly, this is the, both the cycles have been shown on the TS diagram. Similarly, on the right hand side, I have shown the both cycles on the pH diagram also. So you can see on the pH diagram, this is point number 1 at the entry to the compressor. From 1 to 2, it is the isentropic compression in the compressor. 2 to 3 is the heat rejection in the condenser. And 3 to 4 is the isenthalpic expansion in the expansion device. And 4 to 1 is heat addition to the evaporator. And this is the case when the load on the evaporator has not increased, and hence the pressure is still PE, which is the lower pressure. Now, once again, when the pressure has increased in the evaporator, the cycle changes to 1 dash, then 1 dash to 2 dash is the isentropic compression in the compressor. 2 dash to 3, from this particular point to 3, it is the heat rejected in the condenser. And then 3 to 4 dash, now the expansion is taking place up to this particular point because this is the evaporator pressure. Okay, this is the evaporator pressure. So the expansion is now reduced. Okay, so now let us try to understand. I have drawn both the cycles on pH and TS diagrams with the increase in the evaporator pressure. So how it is going to affect the performance of the system? When we say performance of the system, that means we want to talk about what is happening to the coefficient of the performance. what is happening to the mass flow rate of the refrigerant, what is happening to the volumetric efficiency of the refrigerant cycle, what is happening to the power consumption of the system, what is happening to the total cooling capacity of the system, is it going to increase or decrease. So these are certain some performance parameters. So let us see how it is affected by increase in the evaporator pressure. So what I have done here is I have shown two cycles. The first cycle is 1, 2, 3, 4, in which the evaporator pressure is PE, and the second case is 1-2-3-4-1. So this is the cycle when the evaporator pressure has increased. So it is PE dash, which is greater than PE, okay, which is greater than PE. So now I am going to analyze the effect of the increase in pressure in the evaporator. Okay, so let us see. The first thing that I would like to know is what is happening to the specific refrigerating effect. So you can see specific refrigerating effect is given by QE, small QE, and this is the cycle when there is no change in the evaporator pressure. And what we can do is, from our previous class, we know that the specific refrigerating effect is given by the difference in the enthalpies at the exit and the entry to the evaporator. Exit point of the evaporator is 1, entry point is 4. So this value of the specific refrigerating effect is H1 minus H4. Simultaneously, if you see the diagram, when the pressure has increased, then I can say the specific refrigerating effect is given by QE dash. And now the point at the exit from the evaporator is changed to 1 dash and the entry point was 4 dash. So this is the value of the specific refrigerating effect. Now, if you observe the pH diagram carefully, what you can find is this difference, okay, is larger than this difference. This is the value of the specific refrigerating effect when the pressure has not increased. Now, when the pressure increases, the difference has increased. So it means the specific refrigerating effect has actually increased in the evaporator. So this is given here, the effect is QE dash is greater than QE. I have to remove these annotations because when I will be discussing about the specific refrigerating effect, I have to draw the lines again. So here you can say this has specific refrigerating effect has increased. Now let us talk about the compressor, specific compressor work. Now, once again, look at the pH diagram. When we look at the pH diagram, in the case when we are talking about the cycle 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, the entry point to the compressor is 1 and the exit point from the compressor is 2. So 1 to 2 is the isentropic compression. So specific compressor work is given by the enthalpy at the exit from the compressor minus enthalpy at the entry to the compressor. So this is the specific compressor work. Now let us see the second case when the evaporator pressure has increased. Here you will see the entry point to the compressor is changed to 1 dash, whereas the exit point from the compressor is 2 dash. So now the specific compressor work is given by H2 dash minus H1. And you can see it here in the diagram, pH diagram. This is the value of the compressor work before the evaporator pressure increases. This is specific compressor work. After the evaporator pressure has increased, you can see it here. This value is WC dash. So it has, this is WC dash. So it has reduced actually. So compressor work has reduced. Specific compressor work reduces when the evaporator pressure actually increases. So this is shown here. Now let us discuss what happens to the COP value of the cycle actually. Now COP is given by specific refrigerating effect divided by WC. So COP dash will be given by QE dash divided by WC dash. So from the above discussion, we know that the value of QE dash has increased. This value has increased, whereas the specific compressor work has reduced. So numerator increased, denominator has reduced. So it means what will happen to the COP when the evaporator pressure increases? COP dash will increase. So COP dash is more than the COP when the evaporator pressure is lower. So that is the effect of the evaporator pressure on these three parameters. Now the next thing is QC. QC is nothing but the heat rejected in the condenser. So first of all, you should see the diagram here, pH diagram. If you see here, the entry point to the condenser is 2. This is the point, and this is the exit from the condenser. So this is the value of the QC. This is the value of the QC. And when the evaporator pressure increases, this point changes to 2 dash. So now this is the value of QC dash. Okay. This is QC dash. So from here you can see that the heat rejected in the condenser has reduced when the evaporator pressure has increased. So you can see here I have written QC is equal to H2 minus H3. This is the heat rejected by the condenser per kg of the refrigerant. And QC dash is H2 dash minus, not H3 dash, it is H3 only. It has to be H3 only. Okay. So H2 dash minus H3, because state point 3 has not changed in the cycle actually. So here you can see QC dash is less than the value of QC. So heat rejected in the condenser has reduced actually. So these are the four parameters which are the specific quantities apart from the value of COP. So when we increase the evaporator pressure, you can see the specific refrigerating effect increases, specific compressor work goes down, specific heat rejected in the condenser reduces, and the COP, this is the important benefit, that the COP has increased. When the COP increases, it means the power consumption is reduced actually. So it is an important parameter. Now let us talk about the volumetric efficiency of the compressor. Volumetric efficiency of the compressor. Now, the volumetric efficiency you must have studied when you studied the course on thermal engineering 1 or 2, where you have studied the air compressors, and there you derived the formula for the volumetric efficiency that I am going to show here on the next page. First of all, see, this is the equation for the volumetric efficiency. I think you must be knowing this equation. You have studied this equation. It is given by 1 minus C PC by PE. So PC by PE is nothing but the pressure ratio across the compressor. PC is the higher pressure and PE is the lower pressure raised to power 1 by N. What is N? N is the index of compression minus 1. So this is the formula for the volumetric efficiency. Now what exactly volumetric efficiency means? If you understand what is the meaning of the volumetric efficiency, then you can appreciate how we are going to proceed further. That you would be able to understand easily actually. So I am going back to the previous slide. Now you can see it here. Volumetric efficiency is actually given by mass flow rate of the refrigerant. This is mass flow rate of the refrigerant multiplied by this specific volume of the refrigerant which is sucked at the entry to the compressor. So this is basically the specific volume of the point at the entry to the compressor divided by the piston displacement. Now what is this piston displacement? Now this piston displacement is nothing but pi by 4 into d square. This is the diameter of the piston multiplied by length of stroke multiplied by n. N is the revolution per minutes of the motor of the compressor actually. So it can be taken in RPM or RPS. RPM means revolutions per minute and RPS means revolutions per second. So accordingly, now you just try to understand what is volumetric efficiency showing. So it is equal to mass flow rate of the refrigerant multiplied by the specific volume of the refrigerant at entry to the compressor. So basically, it is the product of the mass flow rate and the specific volume. So it shows that how much volume is sucked in comparison to the piston displacement. So in the denominator, it is VP, which is the theoretical piston displacement. So actually, what does it show? Suppose if I say that this is the compressor. Okay, this is the compressor. One valve you can say is the inlet, and other is the delivery valve or discharge valve. Now, when the piston is at the TDC position, we only have the value which is equivalent to VC, which is the clearance volume. We have only the clearance volume. Now, when the piston goes down, actually, when the piston goes downwards, what happens? The refrigerant which is available in the clearance volume starts expanding. Its pressure starts reducing. And till this particular point, let us say this particular point, it is the previous refrigerant which is available between the cylinder head and the piston is expanded. So there is no new refrigerant which is coming into the cylinder actually. Okay. Now, after this particular position, from here onwards, this inlet valve opens, and this further downward movement of the piston causes the refrigerant from the compressor to enter from the evaporator to enter into the compressor through the inlet valve. Okay. So basically, the suction of the refrigerant is this much only. Now, if you theoretically consider, then the piston displacement starts at this particular point, from this particular point. And then let us say this is the stroke length. This is the stroke length. So the volume corresponding to this stroke length is the theoretical piston displacement. But in actual practice, there is only lesser volume which is coming into the compressor. So it is the volumetric efficiency is the ratio of the two. In real sense, it is the mass of the refrigerant which enters into the compressor and divided by the mass of the refrigerant which could fill the entire volume actually, which could fill the entire piston displacement actually. So it relates to that. Now in this case, in the practical sense, the mass which is coming inside the cylinder is less in comparison to the mass if the refrigerant would have started coming inside when the piston is at the top dead center. So I hope this is clear to you. So the value of the volumetric efficiency is always less than 100%. So I hope this is clear to you. And this is the formula for the volumetric efficiency: 1 minus C PC divided by PE raised to power 1 by N minus 1. So this formula can be derived from the equation number 1, which is given here, which is this particular equation. From here, you can derive this equation also. Now, what is C? C is the clearance ratio actually. Now, C is given by VC divided by VS. VC divided by VS. Okay. So, you should always remember that VC divided by VS is the clearance ratio, and its value is somewhere around 0.02 to 0.05. So, I have written here. This is the value of C. C is zero VC by VS, which is clearance volume by stroke volume, and its value varies between 0.02 to 0.05. So that is the variation of the clearance volume to the stroke volume. So it is known as the clearance ratio. C stands for clearance ratio. So it is clearance ratio. Okay, now let us try to understand what happens to the volumetric efficiency. So let us see, when the evaporator pressure increases, what will happen to the volumetric efficiency? This is the formula when there is no change in the evaporator pressure, and this is the pressure ratio PC by PE. Now when the evaporator pressure has increased, this pressure ratio actually reduces. So when this pressure ratio reduces, the whole term in the bracket, this is now reduced, this goes down. So 1 minus smaller value will be K giving higher value of the volumetric efficiency. So I can say when the pressure ratio across the compressor goes down, the volumetric efficiency will increase. So what I have shown here is the two cases I have compared. The one when the evaporator pressure is lower, then the volumetric efficiency is given by eta volumetric. And the second case, when the evaporator pressure has increased, then the volumetric efficiency is given by eta volumetric dash, and it has actually increased. Now, we can use the first equation once again. Let us see what happens now when we use the first equation. We have written that volumetric efficiency is given by the mass flow rate of the refrigerant into specific volume divided by Vp. Vp is piston displacement. Okay, this I told you already. Now, this is the case when the evaporator pressure is PE. In the second case, the evaporator pressure is increased. So, the volumetric efficiency formula will change actually. And from this particular equation, which is written here, okay, from this equation, I can calculate the value of the mass flow rate. Now, mass flow rate will be given by volumetric efficiency into Vp divided by specific volume. This is the equation for the mass flow rate of the refrigerant, which is now circulating through the refrigeration circuit actually. And similarly, the case when the evaporator pressure has increased, I can say that the mass flow rate is given by this formula. It is efficiency volumetric dash into Vp divided by V1 dash. Now, we want to analyze what happens to the mass flow rate. So, first of all, we need to know what is happening to the different parameters. What are the different parameters in this expression for the mass flow rate? One is volumetric efficiency. Second is piston displacement, and the third is specific volume at the entry to the compressor. These are the three parameters which are important. Now let us see. So let us look at this particular equation. Now what happens to the volumetric efficiency when the evaporator pressure increases? So you can see it has increased. This value has increased. So there is chance that the mass flow rate of the refrigerant will increase because this is in the numerator. What happens to Vp? This is the theoretical piston displacement. Is it going to change? No, it will not change. It's going to remain constant because the diameter of the piston is constant, length of stroke of the piston is constant, RPM is also considered to be constant, and pi by 4 is also a constant. So Vp is a constant value. Now let us look what is happening to the specific volume at state point 1 or 1 dash. So these are the two points. Now, can anybody answer how the specific volume changes with pressure? If the pressure increases, what will happen to the specific volume? I want the answer from you people. Yes, tell me. Who would like to tell? What is happening to the specific volume? Okay, so nobody is interested in giving the answer. So I will tell you, if you have a gas and if you increase the pressure, what will happen to the specific volume? Its specific volume will reduce. Okay, its specific volume will reduce. If you will put low pressure, if you will reduce the pressure on a gas in a closed container, then it will expand. So specific volume will increase. So it means it clearly shows that V1 is greater than V1 dash. So V1 dash has gone down. So when V1 dash goes down, what will happen to the mass flow rate of the refrigerant? Volumetric efficiency in the numerator has increased. Specific volume in the denominator has reduced. So mass flow rate, which is being circulated, is increased. So it is clear that the mass flow rate of the refrigerant in the second case has actually increased when the evaporator pressure has increased. Now let us discuss what happens when the mass flow rate of the refrigerant increases. So once again, I have two cycles. The first one, I want to analyze the cycle when the pressure is PE. And the second case, I want to analyze when the pressure has increased to PE dash. Now, QE, this is the total cooling capacity. It is given by mass flow rate of the refrigerant into specific refrigerating effect. And similarly, when the evaporator pressure has increased, it is given by MR dash into QE. So here also, the both the parameters, both the quantities, mass flow rate of the refrigerant and the specific refrigerating effect. So this value and this value both have increased actually. So that is why the value of QE dash has actually increased. So both the values have increased. So it means the total cooling capacity will now increase. That means now the system will give us higher value of the cooling effect. That means the tonnage of the system will increase. If the earlier the tonnage was 1 TR, now it may be giving 1.1 TR or 1.2 TR or maybe 1.05 TR. So the cooling capacity has increased because the evaporator pressure has increased. But mind it, when the evaporator pressure increases, we have to see that whether we want to run the system at that higher pressure and temperature or not. Because any refrigeration system has to work as per the application. For example, if it is a refrigerator, the temperature in the evaporator has to be minus 25. So I don't want that the pressure and the temperature should increase to minus 15 or minus 10, because it will hamper the temperature conditions inside the evaporator, in the refrigerator or the refrigerating machine. So that is important. Okay. And whatever we are talking here, these are only the transient conditions. Now let us discuss about the compressor power. Now the compressor power WC is given by mass flow rate of the refrigerant into specific compressor work. So mass flow rate of the refrigerant has increased when the evaporator pressure has increased. But what happened to the specific compressor work? It actually has reduced. So one thing is increasing, whereas the other thing is reducing. So we are not in a position to find out what happens to the compressor power. So that is why I have written here WC dash. This is the compressor power after the evaporator pressure has increased. Can be greater than or equal to or less than the compressor power before the evaporator pressure has increased. So I hope this much is clear. I have taught you about the effect of the evaporator pressure on the performance of the vapor compression system. So if you have any questions, you can ask me. So tell me, if you have any questions, you can ask.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, actually, my question is that what would be the effect of refrigerant on the system, like the refrigerant properties which are going to affect the system when we increase the pressure in the evaporator?
You mean to say that if we change the refrigerant?
Yes, sir.
See, actually, when we are doing the analysis, okay,
yes, sir.
For this particular topic which I have told you, we are not comparing two different refrigerants. See, when you have to compare, suppose you want to compare your performance in two cases. One could be you appear for an examination in summer season, other could be you appear in the examination in the winter season. So you are the same person actually. So you can always see your mark sheets in winter and your mark sheets in the summer. You will find a difference actually. You appear for the same examination, there may be some difference in the percentage which you get actually, okay? Or when you appear in the examination in winters, so probably you may not be feeling comfortable. In summers, you feel comfortable, okay? So when you have to compare a system, then you will have to compare it for the same refrigerant. There is no question that you will compare the system with different refrigerant. That we will only do when we are changing the refrigerant in a refrigeration system. That how it is going to perform in an existing system, okay? And yes, that is a very important topic also, because nowadays we are switching over from the conventional refrigerants to the alternative refrigerants. But I feel that is a different issue actually. So for the time being, I won't like to discuss that, because it will, this if you talk about the different refrigerant, then the other refrigerant may be having different properties. Okay. And if you are keeping the same pressure and temperature in the evaporator, then you are discussing about the two refrigerants, then you will have to do the analysis. Okay. You have to do the calculation. And without doing calculations, I cannot tell which refrigerant is going to behave in a better manner. And then there may be more problems also. See, when you change the refrigerant, in that particular case, you may have to modify your system also. Okay, system भी change करना पड़ सकता है, क्योंकि ऐसा नहीं है कि अगर आपके पास एक existing setup है, उसमें आप suppose करो कि R134A पे काम कर रहे हो, तो आपने R134A को बाहर निकाला और उसमें दूसरा refrigerant डाल दिया, ऐसा नहीं हो सकता.
Yes,
it is just like human blood. आपके अंदर एक जो blood है, अगर आप blood को change करना चाहते हो, तो आपका जो RH factor होता है, वो same होना चाहिए. O plus है तो O plus का देना पड़ेगा, या O minus है तो O minus देना पड़ेगा, AB है तो AB देना पड़ेगा. So that is the thing. Otherwise यहाँ पे तो system भी change हो जाएगा. अगर आपको refrigerant change करना है, तो कुछ उसमें modification करना पड़ेगा. Otherwise it is not possible. So comparing two refrigeration system, comparing single refrigeration system with two refrigerant is difficult actually. Okay, you have to modify the system and then you can compare the performance. And at this moment, I can't explain that actually. There are, you have to go into the research part actually. Okay, there are certain research paper we discuss this topic also.
Thank you, sir.
Any other?
Sir, I
Sir,
I was asking if there is any effect of the freezing point of the refrigerant on the refrigeration effect of the cycle.
Okay. Freezing point. See, when you talk about the freezing point of the refrigerant, okay. See, at the moment, I would like to tell you that usually we operate at a much higher temperature in comparison to the freezing point, first of all. Okay. And one more thing I would like to tell you, it is not the freezing point, rather it is the normal boiling point of the refrigerant which affects the performance of the refrigeration system. And probably at PTEC level, we don't go into much detail and we don't discuss the effect of the normal boiling point on the various properties also. We discuss this in MTech course actually. If you want to read the effect of the normal boiling point, then you can go to the CP Rora's book. Then there is a topic, the effect of the normal boiling point on the various properties of the refrigerant. Okay, so as such, usually there won't be much effect on the freezing, on the performance of the refrigeration system from the freezing point of view actually. Okay, any other question?
Sir, what will be the effect on the frost that develop at the evaporator if we change the pressure?
Frost.
Yes, sir. That frosting that happens at the evaporator, if we increase the pressure, the mass flow rate will increase. So how will it affect that?
Dekho, frost jo hai, frost formation is because of moisture present in the air. Okay. Naturally, when you are keeping the food products, okay, suppose you are putting the vegetables, they have the moisture content. Okay, if that moisture air also air which is present in the refrigerator also has moisture, no doubt. So the frost formation on the evaporator coil takes place from the moisture which freezes onto the evaporator coil. Now if we are putting more load and if there are food products, and that moisture will also be evaporate, and that would be converted into the frost on the evaporator coil. So naturally the frost formation will increase if you are putting the more product. If you are opening the refrigerator frequently, then also there will be more frost formation, because there will be first of all, the air which enters into the refrigerator, its rate of change will also increase. More opening means more air is coming from outside. There is more moisture which is entering into the system, and there is more frost formation. If you are keeping the refrigerator door closed for a longer duration, no doubt there will be less frost formation, because whatever the frost formation will take place, that would be taken care by the system. It will be converted into the water, and that water will be settling on the pan, which is kept usually on the compressor at the back of the refrigerator.
Okay.
Okay. Any other question? So there are 42 people, including not 42, rather there are 41 students present in this class. So what you can do is you can just wait. I can take a print screen and then you can leave. Just wait. Okay, still what you Shobhit Jain. Shobhit, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Your roll number is not visible. What you can do is you can rename, and then I can take a pic. I can print screen. Name ke saath mein roll number bhi likho. Okay, 219. Just wait. Okay, what you can do is you can all of you can write your attendance. CR is here. CR kaun hai yaar class ka? Varish hai class mein. Okay, Shobhit Jain. So Shobhit, what you do, you give me the attendance. You can take the pic print screen and you can also give me the attendance in a single sheet of paper. Okay, लिख के दे दो या जैसे भी देना है सबके रोल नंबर लिख दो. Okay, all right. Now I am leaving.